Mm-hmm. I will. No, no, I will be. I will be.
You know, all you wallflowers in the back, there's plenty of seats up here. Come right up and get to the splash zone. Except for the guy who walks immediately out. I'll remember you. How many people here? Who here doesn't know who the fuck I am? Awesome. Who the fuck is this guy?
Can you sing
Rollin', rollin', rollin'. What? Is that important? Was that important to something? One. All right, everyone. My name is Jason Scott.
You ride the cock horse.
I ride the cock horse, is a phrase sometimes ascribed to me. I don't know where it comes from. It comes from some sort of ether high, some sort of ether frolic. Well, thank you, everyone, for coming here after midnight to 2600 After Dark. And this is Hackers Got Talent, a show which we must point out has been sanctioned by nobody, is barely running in beta, has many sharp edges, but, is a bunch of people standing up in front of their community to do something. So please remember, even if you, however you respond, please respond with love. This is a bit of bravery on their parts to come out in front of a show with no guidelines. We have no line producers. They were given no consent form to sign. I don't want to get sued for what I say. Also, I have no idea what they're going to do. We're making this up as we go along. So this is the very first time. And we currently have six lovely contestants who are going to show us a talent. And the rules will be explained to you by our judges. We have three wonderful judges here. The first is Rob Vincent. Come on up. Anything to say? Anything to say, Judge?
Hello. Thank you all for coming, and thank those of you who are going to show us what you got. Exactly. We have some very special stuff planned. We've also got some prizes to give out. We've got a small prize, which I'll maybe describe once we're all up here, that every contestant will get, but we've also got some more special things. But before that, I will introduce one more of our judges, one of my distinguished colleagues. Let's all hear it for aesthetics.
All right. Hello, test 1, 2, Donald Trump. Okay, good. It sounds like it's working. Yeah, so there's just two things I have to say. The first is that I'm allergic to Trump steak, and I won't tell you the story behind that. And I've already forgotten the second. The second one is, if you're on drugs, please don't tell me, because so many people have told me that, and I might fuck with you. What? No, if you tell me that you are on drugs, I might tell you to have a good time, and I might have a lot of fun with you. What? I am not answering that question.
If someone asks you if you're on drugs, don't tell either of their heads if you are. And finally, our third judge, the founder of 2600, of course, Emmanuel Goldstein.
You can tell we never did this before because one judge introduced the other, and Jason introduced the first judge and the third judge. But it's that kind of non-tradition that we embrace. So. This is going to be awesome. We've never done it before, and hopefully we'll do it again. New tradition of Hackers Got Talent, because Hackers got a hell of a lot of talent, and I want to see some of it displayed and appreciated. So I hope all you guys, no matter how bad something might seem, maybe it's really something good that's disguised, and let's give it a chance.
How many people from here are out of town? How many of you from out of town? Never been to New York? Okay, of that group,
never been to New York?
Don't be ashamed. How many of you, it's your first time in New York? Okay, nothing closes? Like, you just walk in one direction and have a great time. So if you're like, man, that wasn't very good and now everything's closed, it's not. You're going to go outside and say, Jesus Christ, there's a baby stroller at 2 a.m. Why? What's going on here?
It's not a baby in that stroller.
And it's not a baby in the stroller either.
It's cans.
And they've done stuff. They've done something terrible to Brooklyn, but right now parts of New York are still unbelievable. Man, oh man! My best hope memory after dark was actually one where there was a cockroach, and it was on the corner over here, like over by the, just across the corner. And it was just, and it was there, and it was like 3 inches long, and it just did not give a shit. I mean, seriously, people are walking all around it, and it's like, hey, jefe. Hey.
It sounds like one of the many Hotel Penn amenities.
No, that was Sam. Yeah. We know that one.
Yeah. It might have been a bed bug. Ooh. If you took it home. Anyway, so I'll be your bed bug. All right. So we're just kind of making stuff up. And anyway, so guys, we're literally just gonna, we're gonna barrel forward with this. I believe in a straw poll, Rob got the short straw and now has to explain the rules of Hackers Got Talent.
There are rules.
There are rules.
There are some rules. Each of the distinguished judges on this distinguished panel has scorecards that go up from 1 to 11. Our scores go up to 11. Those who have signed up for this particular trial will come up front, will present what they've got to you, and they will be judged by each of us in turn. Everyone who participates, I'd like to show this off. These are patches of the U.S. Department of Hopeland Security. You might have seen
the.
I watch it.
Yeah, you might have seen the logo of the shady organization displayed around the con for the past few hopes. These are actually cool ones. They come with a Velcro backing that you can sew onto things. So if you actually go through DHS with these things or TSA with these things, you can tear the patch off and maybe actually get to your destination.
Holy shit!
These were made for us. These were given to us by DarkSim905 from Tool, who had these made up because the graphic is online, and he gave us a stack. So we're passing the savings on to you. So this is the cookie for participation, and there are some other things that that people will be getting, I think.
Well, can I add something?
You certainly can.
There's two things that I want to add. The first is that all of us are incredibly sleep deprived and on fumes, and I'm guessing some of you can relate. And the second, how many of you have seen the show America's Got Talent? Because none of us have.
Yeah,
we've never actually seen the show.
Yeah, that actually came out in the email thread. That was one of those, like, who actually put fuel in the machine?
Well, how hard can it's a talent show. How hard can it be?
So anyway, we're doing our own craziness. So why don't we get started with why don't we start it?
We should show off the grand prize, and it's been locked up.
Kyle of 2600 Financial
Wells
Services
Fargo
is now showing.
Bonded.
From our friends at USA, we're going to have a... Oh, sorry. The USA that's entertaining is showing off a Mr. Robot swag pack.
It's a Mr. Robot shopping bag, but there's more. They're inside there.
There's stuff in it too.
Yeah, it's such a shopping bag, isn't it? Look at the colors on that bag. It's Oh wait, there's something in it.
It's Gwyneth Paltrow's head.
Are there Mr. Robot fans here?
Are there any Mr. Robot fans?
There's a few. Okay, I'm scared.
You know, I dressed up as Mr. Robot and went to one at the DerbyCon, and nobody recognized me except for one guy who came up and hugged me and said it's going to be okay.
He was walking through the conference all day yesterday, and nobody said a word with that mask on.
Which is fine. You'll figure out it's pretty fun in about 5 years.
Yeah, sure.
It's pretty good.
The whole thing. No, don't dump it out. That's disrespectful.
That's rude to a prize.
I can hold this.
You should wear it. Put it on.
So this is a sweatshirt, and it says Mr. Robot.
This is a sweatshirt that says Mr. Robot.
We call those Mr. Robot sweatshirts.
Wait. Just show them what's hanging off the collar there, because that's part
collar?
Of it.
Oh, yeah, it's a hood.
Now you know where the word hoodie comes from.
Now, yeah. No, those hooded sweatshirts are very famous.
Those.
Yeah. Okay. F Society diplomatic flag.
Diplomatic flag.
Okay. Very important.
Donald Trump.
I thought it was
good.
I'm trying to get through this. We have this. This is amazing.
Okay.
Eat the
really
mic.
Fancy.
That mic doesn't work.
What? Why is it?
Can we turn up that mic?
We'll turn that mic.
Does anybody know how to turn
Pot
that mic?
Pot up the mic. Pot up the talent mic.
Okay. I think
or as I call it, the bullhorn of talent.
They're noise canceling, and dare I say, they might cancel the voices, right? So.
Okay.
I don't know if they're in the show, but they're in
Asterisk.
The gift bag. So
now Elliot wears earbuds.
Be yours.
Once again, if you're on drugs, do not talk to me.
They're amazing. Asterisk.
And there's some stickers.
And some stickers.
And yeah, everybody gets stickers.
And everybody on the thing is stickers.
Everybody who participates gets stickers.
One patch.
Woo!
Patch.
Precious.
I'm going to improvise a little. Also, whoever ends up with this bag will get some extra patches.
Wow. Awesome.
You can't have my mic.
Wait, somebody has Adderall.
There's no Adderall in the swag bag, okay. I'm sorry to say.
Yeah. The audience has settled into a sort of slight bemusement. That's my favorite.
No spoilers for season
two. Kind of
a
wave of indifference and sadness here in the beautiful Hotel Penn. Thanks again to the Hotel Penn for hosting us yet another year, by the way. We do it many times a year, but yeah, thanks to those guys for existing. As Emmanuel always likes to say, you know, every friggin' year this thing lives is a miracle. This is, you know, you're just
I'd
like...
I say that about everything, though.
Yeah, no.
Is it true they're installing a pool on the roof next time?
They might, but, you know, next year we might use more space. In fact, we will use more space.
If a building smokes crack, this is that building. Yeah. anybody here ever walk down a hallway and be like, oh, this is sure, I'm surely not on the corporeal dimension again? A couple of those, you walk in, you're like, no. Wow, they have an announcement system. No, it doesn't. It's amazing. Anyway, so thanks again to the Hotel Penn for sticking around and being our friend. All right, let's go get this thing. Is that potted up?
Stay off the damn roof, please.
Are we doing that? Is that working? Is that working now?
Yeah. Yes.
So, all right, everybody. Can we get one more round of applause for the people who actually are brave enough to beta test this bullshit? Yeah, here at Hackers Got Talent. All right. Is this actually traveling? Is this going? This is going? I guess there's no... is the camera aiming at me? Oh, there it is. The camera's like, oh, why not? Awesome. Thanks again to the live streaming, and I'm so sorry to everyone out there. I think it's people in Europe waking up going like, why did I get up for this shit? It's 5 o'clock in the morning in Germany, like, why am I here? This is what they deserve, Donald Trump. What the fuck's wrong with those people? All right. Should we just start? I think we should start.
I think we should.
All right, let's just start.
Let's start.
All right. Well, our first contestant here on Hackers Got Talent is Jeff Patty. Am I getting it right? Jeff Patty, are you here?
Come on down. The Price is Right. Oh, wait, wrong show.
So, I think I should say what Jeff has claimed that he will do, as opposed to having him describe.
Are there two Jeffs?
Right. So you're allowed. You're allowed. This is New York. Yeah. You pair everybody up. Everything's cool. It's legal. It's good. We'll count you. Jeff Patty and?
Robert Smee.
That's your hacker name?
Smead.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. The Smead. Sure. Okay. One of my services for people is that if you need it, I can give you a hacker name. So if you have a problem, you need a hacker name, I'll give it to you. Huh? No. Your name. Okay. Your name.
You ride the cock horse.
Cock. When did you lose control of the crowd, Jason? And it says here that your talent is speed Rubik's Cube solving.
Ooh.
Quote unquote, less than 45 seconds, it says on the tin. Okay.
So we're
going to get out of the way for this blindingly fast. Yeah. Anyone here not know what a Rubik's Cube is? Ask your dad. Okay, here we go. So let's get this show on the road. I think that.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Jason, what, can we pass it down and we all like?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I broke it.
You broke it. Oh, is that where you store the SD card?
How'd you know?
Hack the cube. Hack the power cube.
Hang on.
This cube is full of heroin.
I'm trying to solve it.
Oh, heroin cube. Why did I bring you?
So this is what we call pseudo random number generator.
Pseudo random, yeah. Okay.
It's taking us longer to randomize.
No MD5 collisions.
I had to make sure it was a high enough key. Yeah.
What? So you're each gonna do one? I guess is that fine, judges? They each want to do it once.
Okay.
As their show.
Just to rub it a little.
We might not be as excited the second time, but
Second time is kind of a little slower. Need a little time between the two.
So are we going to judge the first one, the second one, or both of them combined?
They get one score because they're one
act. You're going to do it. You're going to are we going to average it?
I think they're both collaborating on this. They'll have to share any prizes.
Okay. All right. We're grading this one on the curb. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
So I think Well, I guess we got to have you this way, right? Because I mean, you don't want him to turn around and go there. Fuck those guys. You guys want to see this done in front of you, right? Yeah. Yeah, we need. All right. Let the judges know your opinion.
So go ahead, get over there.
And the important thing, Emmanuel, is that you asked for this.
Who's
remember
got a timer?
That.
Oh, you got a timer. Okay.
Wait, are we using your timer? Did you rig
they
your timer?
Brought their own timer.
I got a timer.
This timer is really suspiciously slow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's even better. Oh, that's right. Well, you don't need a mic to solve a Rubik's Cube. Right, okay.
We need to assign a timekeper, and I think Rob T. Firefly is.
Yeah, let's do a countdown.
All right. Audience, help me out with this. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hack the cube! Solve the cube! Solve the cube! Solve the cube! Solve the cube! Cube is winning! Cube's ahead! Cube in the lead! Cube around the bend! Here comes the cube! Cube is owning you!
Did we say we were going to make this really hard on you?
So far, the cube is displaying an amazing bunch of talent.
Oh!
Fuck!
Oh!
How did you do that?
Wait! Okay.
I've seen that on YouTube. What the fuck?
You guys, the timing on this is very nearly perfect because this was solved in 25.98 seconds.
Not quite 26.
Two more hundredths of a second, and I could have really had something. But
yeah, I don't know. 26 would have been a little.
Yeah.
The next set.
Well, how about and now the next set of pseudo random number generation. What? Yeah, that is on.
All right. Full disclosure, mine might be a little bit slower.
I've lost the timer on this. You need to bring back the timer.
My thing is, I solve it upside down, which to anybody that cubes out there is a hallmark of doing the first two layers at one time, and that's just the way I solve it. And so that's my little gimmick, I guess.
He said he's going to do it a different way. We're all buying in.
All right.
I mean, they've already got us in right here. It's the gambler's fallacy, right? We're already invested in one round. Why not get two rounds? And he's going to do a trick for us and his friend, their
like
package deal, and we're happy with
body
it.
English?
That would be interesting.
When you say you're going to... Okay, so just so I understand this, you just used the phrase, I'm going to solve this upside down.
Hold the cube upside down. I start with the bottom layer and work up instead of the other way around.
That is a distinction... Nobody in this room will understand.
Yeah.
It has been explained that he's going to solve it upside down, and as we say in cube parlance, I guess, that means he's going to solve the bottom layer up and come up, and he's going to do that. But okay, get up on stage. Get up on stage. We all have to see this.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, okay.
All right. Once again, we need
the best magic tricks are the ones where you have to explain it. That was the best.
Okay, if you're ready, we'll count you down again.
He's the strong but solving type.
Audience, help me out again. 1, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go!
Solve the cube! Solve the cube! Using whatever method, don't understand. It's meaningful to you. It's your personal religion. You are the Pope of solving the cube. Look at you go.
I don't know what you're doing.
It's really impressive to some sort of idea. Not sure what's happening. Why am I shouting alone? I feel sort of alone. Doesn't really matter. Embarrassment's not in my personality. Character doesn't do it. Useless guy in the crowd. Lots of things going on. Hooray, hooray, hooray. Hecklers are dumb. Da 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 da. I am a heckler. And oh my God. Yeah.
Oh. Our final ruling, 42.63 seconds.
Yeah.
Also,
so
you have a Snapchat.
Oh, I got a Snapchat.
Yeah. You can have this back. Each of you get one of these.
No matter what, no matter how it ends up.
Patches.
Okay,
and,
so
what happened?
So that's absolutely real.
That time.
Do we have any idea I think we just can't, like, there's no metric. Like, it's not like the next person coming up who's going to sing is going to be like, well, I can sing in 45 seconds. I mean, it's not going to be like that.
I
would say that their claim was, we can solve it in less than 45 seconds. We watched the thing.
They were
successful. You have all seen it. Keep it in your minds. Think Rubik's Cube and arbitrary. And thank you so much for your contribution. Please, a round of applause.
So now we vote.
What?
We vote now. With our cards.
You vote now? Is that when it happens?
Well, we have the cards. So
Okay. Okay.
as you know, Rob T. Firefly of Radio is off the hook, I think that's the rule. I think we get to vote now.
Okay, I guess we vote now in the now made-up rules that we're following, soon to become a tradition, yes. And people saying, of course, it made sense the first time.
It's a Hacker's Got Talent tradition.
Best and, rule set ever. Go ahead. All right, go ahead, fine.
So we hold up our cards at the same moment.
Is that really what we do?
And okay. And then, if we want to, we explain...
I wanted to cheat off Rob.
Justify our votes.
Okay, let's see it. Bring up, what do the judges say?
I think we need another countdown for that.
3, 2, 1, score!
Okay. I think that means we win and Aesthetics loses.
Yeah, I lost. Okay.
Okay, so I voted 9. Can I just say why I voted 9? I was less impressed with solving the Rubik's Cube as solving it in less than 45 seconds, and he got all the way to 42. He got it really precisely.
Okay.
Very close. Yeah. I was impressed by that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We should write that down. Wait. We should write this down somewhere.
We have a story.
Okay, Kyle. Okay, go. Kyle's on it. That's the slogan. Kyle's on it. All right, number 2. Let's go for contestant number 2. Are you ready for contestant number 2? We call him the Golden Voice of Florida. This, of course, is Cheshire Catalyst. The Cheshire Catalyst.
Cheshire is not missing
good
tonight.
Good morning.
A legend, and I do love you, man. You are friggin' awesome.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm really, yeah.
Cheshire ran registration
really
for the first
Hope
Conference.
To reveal to the world an aspect of my area code. Now, for those who don't know, back in 1999, I went to the Florida Public Service Commission hearing that was splitting the 407 area code. I explained to them that Cape Canaveral, the countdown capital of the world, should, in my humble opinion, get area code 321. They liked the idea. The thing is that I had an inspiration, which I didn't realize at the time, and that was my true hero, Tom Lehrer. Now, Tom Lehrer used to write funny songs, and he got to thinking about the nostalgic songs of World War I, World War II, and you know, if we're going to have nostalgic songs about World War III, we ought to start writing them now. Well, he did so. I'm about to sing it for you. But he left this 3-beat pause in the middle of the bridge. But I have always filled in that bridge myself with my own lyrics, which I seemed appropriate to the song as I would sing it in the shower nearly every day. So there I am going down the list of area codes. You know the list. 201 New Jersey, 202 DC, blah, blah, blah. Gaps marked available for geographic relief. And I say, 321. Why does that sound familiar? Oh, I live near Cape Canaveral, the countdown capital. And of course, that's the area code I took to the Public Service Commission. Well, let me see now. Let's start it up and see how it goes.
Okay, so officially it is Cheshire Catalyst sings Tom Lehrer's So Long, Mom.
Oh, hang on. Sorry about that.
It's in beta. Shut up.
Well, that was a short song.
When has streaming music ever worked for you?
So long, Mom. I'm off to drop the bomb. So don't wait up for me. But while you swelter down there in your shelter, you can see me on your TV. While we're attacking frontally, watch sprinkly and huntily, describing contrapuntally the cities we have lost. No need for you to miss a minute of the agonizing Holocaust. Oh yeah! Little Johnny Jones, he was a U.S. pilot, and no shrinking violet was he. 3, 2, 1. He was mighty proud when World War III was declared. He wasn't scared, no siree. And this is what he said on his way to Armageddon. So long, Mom. I'm off to drop the bomb. So don't wait up for me. But though I may roam, I'll come back to my home. Although it may be a pile of debris. Remember, Mommy, I'm off to get a commie. So send me a salami and try to smile somehow. I'll look for you when the war is over. An hour and a half from now.
Wait, come back up here. Come back
up here.
Amazing, amazing, amazing.
And welcome now you see where the 3-2-1 came from.
He waited 11 hopes to show this talent.
Chesh, come back up here. We're not done with you.
Wow, 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 wow.
First of all,
get
have
your
a
patch. Get your patch. Yes. Yep. Hope Land Security has the best freedom fondle in the business.
Yes, indeed. All right.
And I believe, have our judges assembled their scores for the Cheshire Catalyst performance of Tom Lehrer's So Long, Mom, I'm Off to Drop the Bomb. Are we ready? All right, let's see if this time all three of you can do it at once. Show us your scores, judges.
Numbers are confusing.
3, 2, 1. L! What we got?
Yes, they're being recorded by our official scorekeeper.
I'm on it.
Whose name is Kyle?
After each one, we're writing over the numbers, the previous one. What the fuck do you think? So far, we've gotten a full 6 numbers out. After a half an hour, we have produced 6. I think we can actually ask somebody what all the numbers were up to this point, and they would know, wouldn't they?
We're getting better at this.
You're smart people. All right. All right. Thank. Did any of the judges feel the need to explain their judging?
Just, you know, I've known Cheshire for a while. I think I always kind of knew he had it in him, but I was never quite sure. Now I'm sure.
Okay. anything else? Anything? Oh, okay.
It was really funny.
It was. It's a classic.
It was a set.
It's a classic. If you've never heard Tom Lehrer, you know, go. There's some awesome crap out there. Do it.
It was an upside down 7. That's what I thought.
Okay, so I think we're going to go to number 3 contestant out of 6. Once again, reminding you, each contestant is bravely plunging backwards into whatever the hell this is, into the abyss, has no idea what they're in for, so please show love and applause. This is, I see his hacker name is Dave.
Is there a Dave in the room?
You can change the
He's
world
not here,
with
man.
One or two great rock songs. Is the name of your...
Does anybody have a guitar?
Talent.
Does anybody have a guitar?
What are you, Instant Brownie Mix? You show up and you don't have any...
Hold on, I got a backup plan.
You're the Stone Soup of talent. I like that.
What kind of pseudo-hacker do you think I am?
Does anybody
guitar notes.
Have
more,
a guitar?
One more time. Anybody got a guitar in here?
Does anybody
I've been looking for one for 24 hours.
Guitar?
Should radio for one.
Could we radio for a guitar? Why don't we call 911 for a guitar? I guess 311.
There's a guitar.
All right, I thought 24 hours is enough, especially with this creative group.
He asked us
but
this
if nobody
yesterday.
In here has a guitar, I'm prepared to go on with something else.
There's an app for
there's
that?
An app? There's a guitar app? Okay.
I've got a lot. Well, first of all, I'm Dave, of course, like you all know.
Hi, Dave.
Hello.
Seems like an AA meeting. This is my 4th hope. And when I came here I came here 6 years ago, I guess, in 2010. I immediately found a lot of community and friends and thank you. And a lot of welcome and stuff. And I've greatly benefited from that coming back each year. So I appreciate everything that Emmanuel and everybody at the staff 2600 does.
You still can't have my Bud Light.
So I've got a lot of respect to you for Lloyd Blankenship or the mentor. And took a lot of value in this thing that I found on the internet many years ago, and it really encouraged me to not only work in technology but eventually live out my dream by working in network security on a regular basis. And these days, I don't even have to work overnight shift anymore. So anyway, here's the Conscience of a Hacker by the mentor, and this is actually directly from Frack, and of course 2600's already reprinted this too, I believe. Another one got caught today. It's all over the papers. Teenage arrested in computer crime scandal. Hacker arrested after bank tampering. Damn kids, they're all alike. But did you and your 3-piece psychology and 1950s techno brain ever take a look behind the eyes of a hacker? Did you ever wonder what made him tick? What forces shaped him or her? What may have molded him? I'm a hacker. Enter my world. Mine is a world that begins with school. I'm smarter than most, than the other kids. This crap they teach us bores me. Damn underachiever, they're all alike. I'm in junior high or high school. I've listened to teachers explain for the 15th time how to reduce a fraction. I understand it. Nah, Ma, Smith. I didn't show my work. I did it in my head. Damn kid, probably copied it. They're all alike. I made a discovery today. I found a computer. Wait a second, this is cool. It does what I want it to do. If it makes a mistake, it's because I screwed up, not because it doesn't like me, or feels threatened by me, or thinks I'm a smartass, or doesn't like teaching and showing, or and shouldn't be here. Damn kid, all he does is play games. They're all alike. And then it happened, a door opened to a world rushing through the phone line like heroin through an addict's veins. An electronic pulse is sent out, a refuge from the day-to-day incompetency's assault. A board is found. This is it. This is where I belong. I know everyone here, even if I've never met them, never talked to them, may never hear from them again. I know you all. Damn kid, tying up the phone line, they're all alike. You bet your ass we're all alike. We've been spoon-fed baby food at school when we've hungered for steak. The bite of meat that you did let slip through were pre-chewed and tasteless. We've been dominated by sadists or ignored by the apathetic. The few that had something to teach found us willing pupils, but those few are like drops of water in the desert. This is our world now, the world of the electron and the switch, the beauty of the bod. We make use of a service already existing without paying for what could be dirt cheap if it wasn't run by profiteering gluttons. And you call us criminals? We explore and you call us criminals? We seek after knowledge and you call us criminals? We exist without skin color, without nationality, without religious bias, and you call us criminals? You build atomic bombs, you wage wars, you murder, cheat, and lie to us, and try to make us believe it's for our own good. But we're the criminals? Yes, I am a criminal. My crime is that of curiosity. My crime is that of judging people by what they say and think, not by what they look like. My crime is that of outsmarting you, something that you will never forgive me for. I'm a hacker, and this is my manifesto. You may stop this individual, but you can't stop us all. After all, we're all alike. The Mentor. Thanks.
So once again, that was Dave reading from The Howl.
I'll play guitar next time.
That was Dave reading from The Howl of Hacker Manifestos, The Hacker Manifesto. So, awesome. See how much more cultured we are. I bet you America Got Talent has no poetry readings. We're really ahead of this. We're ahead of the curve. I'm
Man,
just saying.
If he had a guitar, that would have been awesome.
Yeah. Without that guitar, Jesus, why do we even sit through that? You're right. It was like missing. It was like drinking. Yeah. It was like no gimlet. Anyway. So All right. So I believe the judges have their numbers ready. Okay. So here we go for Dave, You Can Change the World with One or Two Great Rock Songs / I Mean, Let Me Read from the Mentor's Hacker Manifesto. 3, 2, 1. You can see how shitty this is that I have to walk down to see what they got. Anyway.
I do have one comment.
Do we have any comments? Go ahead.
What year was that from? It was like 86 or something?
86, yeah.
I just wanted to point out to everyone, you may have seen this from the talks here this weekend, you just change a couple of words in that, like the technologies, and it's the same fucking thing as we have today. So.
Exactly.
Except nowadays you can judge hackers by their skin color before you've met them and so on.
Damn kids, they all playing Pokemon Go.
Just use IRC.
I should also mention, we also have Mr. Robot stickers to give away for all the participants, so the first couple of you didn't get the stickers.
Yeah,
so,
come
Chesh,
on
we have some of these for you, and our Rubik's Cubist,
get your stickers ready.
We have some stickers for you if you want to come up and get them.
So, okay. So,
we're at the halfway point.
Yeah, the next one's, well, okay, so, I'm going to switch the order just slightly, so we have a variation. Oh, I'm here for the... Give me the stickers. I want the sticker. Why aren't you up here? Why aren't you up here on Talent Row? You're gonna have to. Yeah.
Talent Row. What's that?
That's the front row.
It's the front row. Talent Row.
Oh, all right, great, yeah.
We're good.
Well, what's your talent? Yeah.
Let's make somebody's nightmare. You're next on the show. What show? I didn't apply for a, oh my God, wake up, drenched pillow. All right.
We should make one random seat, a participant, a non-willing participant.
Our next contestant is Stephen Martin Cohen. Hello, Mr. Cohen. Welcome to Hackers Got Talent, or as we like to call it, nobody worked out how this is played. And your listed talent is nothing. I don't have it listed here, so please explain to the audience.
One over.
What are you bringing to the table, sir?
I'm going to talk about my job titles and various things that I've done in a few jobs.
So for the record, sir, you're saying
I've
are these jobs legal?
Wait, you're saying so what you're saying is your talent is you're going to read us your resume.
I'm going to tell you stories of actual employment.
Okay, remember that each one of these people has a bed somewhere, so be sure. Remember, brevity is the spice of life,
the soul of wit,
and the salt of the earth.
And
is the spice of the brevity.
Okay.
Also, after 5 minutes, we get the big hug.
Okay, let's have some brevity.
Let's bring this on, Mr. Cohen. Tell us what you got.
Okay. I worked at a company called PRD, which stands for Polytechnic Research and Development. They were in Syosset, New York. I was a job shopper. I worked in a room full of job shoppers. They put their names on a sheet of paper on the wall. I used to add a name every day, Uncle Peculiar, Mambusu Rosaflex. I had to, have my fun. I added things. Well, one of the things that they did, they took a pet computer, thousands of them, and they invested tens of thousands of hours. Now, this was back when 64K of memory meant something, if anyone knows the Commodore PET. Well, they took out of BASIC, they wrote thousands of lines of BASIC code to create a machine language. So you have to appreciate how insane this was. They created a machine language which then used so much memory that you could only write 200 lines of code to test hardware. And it was lame. It was like a COP 4-bit microprocessor code. I mean, it was really stupid. And if you've ever done any coding, you appreciate how dumb this was. So out of the 200 lines of code you had left over, using the machine language to create an interpretive language to then recreate a machine language. Like, wrap your mind around this. And it was bad machine language also. And then you would then bit bang to test hardware. Like you would, my job was to test a, what? It was like to test a 16 word by 8-bit, by 9-bit memory. So you would have to put out an address, put out data, clock the bit one at a time. So I wrote a lot of subroutines to do this, to try to use the code more effectively, because someone had written like 15 or 20 load modules where they'd load one bit pattern, then another bit pattern, then another bit pattern. And I wrote a program so I could have, checkerboard patterns and moving ones and moving zeros. And, I compressed it. And I had lots of comment statements that explained how it was working. And the thing worked. So one day, a guy from the company comes in and talks across the room. And there are maybe 15 or 20 job shoppers in this room. And he says, I don't understand how this program works. I said, well, does it work? And he said, well, yeah, it works, but I don't understand how it works. And then he said, he said, you write software with all these subroutines just like this other Jewish guy who worked here. So I said, without skipping a beat, I said, I never wrote a Jewish subroutine in my life. All my subroutines are Gentile. Now, I thought that was hilarious, but there was dead silence in the room. It just sailing over everyone's head. And now, one of the other things I did, now, his story, I'm actually going to change what I was going to say a little bit. One of the things I did was I wrote a program to test this relay test bay for this thing that passed RF signals, and a relay would close, and it would close one data point to one point to another point. You'd measure with an ohmmeter. Now, I wrote a program, and there were seven, you could choose seven programs to run. And if you chose an eight or more or less than one, I would actually, I had it print out, are you on drugs? Now, this is for
don't
the military.
Tell me.
But you can't say print, quote, are you on drugs? So I had to write the ASCII code for all the letters and then run a program to actually then display it. So somewhere, someone's going to be on drugs, and that program is going to display, are you on drugs? Well, I said, and you know, kid you not, this is an, and then also, to look at the connectors, they put me in a room that was dark, and there was no light to look at these Bendix connectors with like terminal AA of terminal of connector 16 connects to this pin of that, and you couldn't see it because it was dark. So I needed a light. Now, you want to know why like a toilet seat costs $200 or why things, they can't give you $19 to go to Kmart to buy a light because the opportunity for malfeasance is too great. Like if you went to Kmart, I mean, let's say your brother-in-law works there and he's getting a 12-cent kickback. I mean, that the military industry, so they sent out a request for proposal, and of course there's a minimum buy of like 500 units. Like this, like that light could cost $14,000 for that one light, so you could look at the fucking, you know, AA pin terminal AA. So I was a pain in the ass, or was a perennial pain in the ass. I go to my bosses, like four levels of management up, and I got permission to pull, because they never throw anything out. So they have stock rooms full of broken lights. Out of that, I made one working light, and it only cost the taxpayer 8 hours of my time billing at $26 an hour. And this is, that was the cheapest solution, because they really wanted me to sit there and read the newspaper for 6 weeks while this went through a quest for proposal, and they got three competitive bids so that they could provide me with a light, with one, you know, one of those lights, you fold it with the springs on it and you position it. So much for that. So, all right, years later, I have another job as a toy inventor. This was my dream job because I got to work on every kind of technology imaginable. And, you know, I'm mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, software, whatever it was, digital signal processing with a TMS 7000 chip. This was amazing. So I built a harmonizer based on an algorithm that I dreamt up during an LSD trip a few years earlier, where you read data into the memory at a different rate than you read it out, so it'll either pitch shift up or pitch shift down. And I never told the boss that I dreamt this up on an acid trip, because you can't say that, you know. So I dream these things up at night, you know. I'm on the train going to my job. Wait, is it timeout? Oh, I'm still going. Oh, wait. I'm on the train going to my job, and at that time there's this white guy reading the newspaper, and someone was like burying children in the basement somewhere, and the headline in like giant like 600 point type was like, how many kids? But the way his hand was holding the paper, it looked like the K was a Y. And so I'm straining and I'm looking and I'm trying to see, is that a Y? Did they really print the Daily News? Did they do that? So I'm looking at this thing, and then finally, he sees me looking, and he folds the paper in half. He folds it in half again. He says, if you want to read the paper, why don't you just buy one? He's screaming, and the whole train is here, is listening to this. So at that moment, I said, what would Bugs Bunny do? I walked across to him. I actually walked up to him, and I said, I wasn't looking at your paper. I was looking at the hematoma on your neck. And he said, hematoma? Melanoma? And I said, no, hematoma. Only 40% of them metastasize and become malignant. And then he said, who are you? And I'm touching his neck. I'm actually touching a stranger's neck. I'm touching a stranger's neck, and I'm looking at it. And he's saying, who are you? And I said, oh, I'm a dermatological, I'm a postdoc at Rockefeller University studying dermatological disorders. Now, if you spit it out like that, he's going to believe you. You know, So I, you know, talk about social engineering. So, I mean, I hacked this motherfucker's mind. I went right into his head. Said that was the LSD, but I didn't say that. So I'm like now touching this man's neck. He's freaking that now. Suddenly, all the anger went out. His face is white. And then Jesse was about to, I said, yeah, definitely stage three. Now he's rubbing his neck. He's rubbing his neck. And then as he's about to talk, I said, do you have insurance? And he says, yeah. I said, well, you better get to a dermatologist right away. And with that, the doors opened at 14th Street, and I walked out. And I walked out, and then I just left white boy over there, this three-piece suit, and he's like, oh, my God, and he's rubbing his neck. He probably gave himself some type of a disorder. So then the same day, I'm in the office. I'm talking to the boss, and there's a knock on the door. And I open the door, and there's a guy who says, how would you like to buy a nice Deer Park spring water cooler for your office? And I said, nah, we're not interested in any dihydrogen oxide. And then, knowing he was going to say this, he said, oh, you won't find any of that in our water. So I said, that's what I was afraid of. Now get the fuck out of here, you asshole. And I slung the door, and my boss, like, was banging his head against the door, like, just, you know, did this extemporaneously. And then I had a number of job titles also. You know, you fill in the bingo cards, and I couldn't resist. There's that category called other, because I'm not a marketing, I'm not sales, I'm not engineer. I do manufacturing, I do engineering, I do a lot of things, R&D, but I'm not like any one, so it's other. That was it. So my first job title, when you put your toe in the water, my first job title was human dehumanizer. Is it out of here? Is that it? Do I still go? Do I keep going? Oh, I died. Well, then I another job title was Negro Control Officer. That was like over the top. But then I wrote Lingerie Control Officer. That was enough. They wanted to know what a lingerie control... So someone called up from the magazine, Lingerie Control Officer, what does that mean? So finally the woman gets me on the phone from the magazine, and I said... she said, you're a hard guy to get in touch with. I said, well, I am a functional heroin addict. So right away she's like freaking out. I said, oh yeah, you cook it up in a spoon, you inject it. Really takes the edge off a day in work, you know. She says, well... What is your job title? And so I said, well, what do you have? Because it could have been any one of like five different job titles. So she said, Lingerie Control Officer. I said, oh, that's correct. She says, well, what does a Lingerie Control Officer do in an engineering company? I said, well, it's really very simple. I check when all the women come to the office. I make them get undressed and show me what underwear they have. And if it doesn't meet the company standards, I make them get undressed. I make them go home and come back until they meet the company standards. And they thought that I could almost hear her head exploding. She must be thinking, they have a junkie checking women's underwear.
What the fuck?
Stephen Martin Cohen.
And there's more.
That doesn't have a name in our language, what just happened here. Okay, and now we ask, oh, that was Stephen Martin Cohen with...
I am a published author. I've actually been published. My book was the first book ever electronically submitted to Warner Books. And I was the beta site and torture victim.
Okay. Wow. You did this. I was right there. I was sneaking up on him. I knew his vision was based on movement. And you all just said, we want more. We want more. Switch hands, keep hammering. And it happened. And we let it happen. So
I'm not sure what
now
just
the
happened.
Judges
oh God.
Will convert that to a number.
Wow.
And they'll hold it up as if the number indicates what just happened. And we will all clap because that's what we think they did. So will the judges... Oh, I got to see this one. All right, judges. Bring it up. Three,
two, one.
By the way, my number is upside down because I'm not sure what just happened. So,
Rob, are you sure you don't have a typo there?
No, I think...
You've got it? You've walked it through?
You're going to
let this
there.
Pack of animals... You're going to throw that meat?
There. You know, I think I'm...
All right, you're holding
firm. I think I'm going to have to stand by this, and I look forward to your ass beating out in the hallway after this.
Okay.
Can I call for a vote?
Only because I've heard that story before.
Wait a second.
All right, good one.
Can we judge the judge? I'd like to judge judge number three.
All right.
Thank you. All right.
I can do that.
You can do that. There can be a recall.
Wait, but we could vote on judges?
Yes.
Really?
I'm trying to tell you, yes.
When did you tell me this?
It's a democracy.
Wait, can we judge the audience, too?
Hacker name Mandy.
Oh, awesome.
Mandy, are you in the audience? Mandy? Oh, man. Ladies and gentlemen, Mandy is dead. Oh, is Mandy here? Mandy, come. Oh, hello, Mandy. Hi, Mandy.
Come straight from the airport?
Tell us about your resume. Mandy has put down juggling, comma,
Druggling?
Maybe not so good. Which I think is nice. I mean, it's nice. Put that on the tin. But I figured it was an unscripted...
Okay, that's true.
Is this the juggling axes thing we're talking about?
Ooh.
Is she going to be juggling axes or just balls?
I like pretty lights.
Can people hear me talking to myself?
Do they blink?
Lights! Too? Lights down! Someone hit the lights!
Can you make them blink too?
Our blue haired Mercury is. Okay!
Oh! All right.
I have a request for blinking, so you gotta give me a moment. Hold on a second.
I'm glad the last one wasn't like this.
Oh, yay! Blinky lights!
Oh, excellent.
Oh, I think you should have held that up for the. Okay, all right. Let's hear it for balls, please.
If this is your first time at Burning Man.
All right.
I said it wasn't going to be too good.
Yeah! Yes. Oh, lights back on.
No. Lights off again.
Oh my God. You're not
lights
implying.
Off again, please.
You are.
Oh, there we go. Lights back up. Thank you.
Does anybody have drugs?
Is that a talent?
So, once again, that is Mandy with juggling. Thank you so much for that, Mandy. It was a real palate cleanser.
Thank you.
I'm going to wake up tomorrow morning with stories in my head going, I don't know whose stories these are. Oh, my God. Thank you again, Mandy. So our final contestant. Oh, sorry. No, beta. Judges, yes. Have you prepared your numbers?
Yes.
Here we go. Three,
two, one.
I thought it was very similar to the one before.
Okay.
All I know is there are blinky lights.
Yeah, she gets the firefly bonus from me. That's
This turns out the judges like shiny lights. Soft rugs.
Mm-hmm.
sunlight spots. All right, so we're going to go to our sixth and final contestant of the night.
Aw.
Aw. But no, don't say aw. I think they're very good. And their name is Comet Crowbar. Comet Crowbar, where are you? There you are. Now, Comet, you've put down a title that would make me pick it up from the magazine rack.
Great, you should.
And it's called Reading From, and let me make sure I'm reading this correctly, Crypto Cunt and the Ecosexuals is the name?
The subtitle, The Very Queer Story of the NSA Headquarters is in this Berlin.
Now, is this a golden book, or is this a...
Okay. Can I... Is this all right? Yeah, so I wrote this book. It's a fiction book. I'm a bit tall. I want to make sure that's, like, up here. Yeah, I wrote this book. Great. Hi. Hello. Can you hear me? Okay. So, yeah, I talked about this a bit in my talk earlier. Yeah, good. So it's about, in a nutshell, this, like, so I'm going to read a chapter. It's going to be approximately 7 minutes. It won't be under 45 seconds. It won't be upside down. I thought it won't be anything you've seen so far. It will be some stuff. So, okay, general plot, because it's like, I'm going to read from a piece in the middle. It's about, okay, there's like this eco-terrorist cult of like bicycle-riding anarchist hackers versus the NSA, like these two people who work in the headquarters. In the NSA, it's all fiction, but like, is it fiction? And they are like trying to hunt down this like ecosexual culty orgy. Like, they don't know what the fuck is up. So this is this. And one of the main characters is called the Officer. He's like this campy guy who works in the NSA. And okay, so here's a picture of the Ausländerbehörde. I lived in Berlin and like had to apply for visas for 5 fucking years. Like. You can see how I feel about the Foreign Office building. And so it got bombed by the ecosexuals. And then this is the chapter now is a few months later. It's called Ausländer Bescheiser.
Oh, Jesus.
Chapter 7. Okay. No, ecosexual is not on Tinder. It's a book. You can read it. It's not an app or a person. Okay. All right. So, and it is about hacking, by the way. So, despite being a lead officer in a prestigious U.S. agency, the officer is still an Ausländer and must renew his visa like any other Ausländer. Granted, his I request silence, thank you. Shut the fuck up. All right. Also, let's get a woman up here next time. Yeah, I said it, all right.
Okay. Now, wait a minute. I have a different opinion. Wait. Fuck hecklers who can't get the balls
to
come up
in front
of an
audience.
Book
here,
that's
okay?
Right.
It's kind of fucking and like a
and have
full
to
of
make
dudes
it all
like
about
okay.
themselves. So, their special party show. You could have filled it out. You didn't do it. You took
okay.
the wrong.
Okay. Granted, his application is basically pre-approved breeze, stamped and signed by the Bundesnachrichtendienst themselves. But the process of physically trudging down to the Ausländerbehörde is still the same. By now, a few months since the terrorist attack, from the picture earlier, most of the building has been repaired. He has designated space to report to, section Z6, room C63 on the second floor, is for United States citizens whose last name is in the latter half of the alphabet. His waiting number is 212 for an appointment scheduled at 9 a.m. I can't believe I have to wait in line for this bullshit. I'm an officer. Oh. He stares out the window at the ridiculous Easter egg-colored apartment complex across the river. It exists.
Yes,
in
it
Berlin.
Does.
The irony of such a building is almost laughable, considering the clouds of depression and bureaucratic nightmares that go on in this building he's in. He assumes it was painted brightly to cheer up those who are destined for rejection, who only sit and look out the window hopefully as they wait to be called. The triple-digit numbers are displayed in two columns. Like the when you're waiting in an office and like there's the numbers. Though his job is deciphering patterns in code, he cannot fathom what algorithm is used for the display of such numbers. No consistency, bells dinging that sickly three ding, doo, doo, doo. Next up. next for no reason and flashing at total random. He looks out the other window, yawns loudly, and looks back at the number display. His eyes bulge and he almost chokes in shock. The red digits have been hacked into stick figures. He looks around incredulously. What the fuck? What the fuck? The red lights have, he looks around. Is anyone else aware of this? Most applicants are nervously flipping through their papers or on their phone. He looks back at the stick people and they're fucking, oh my God, how is this happening? Somehow, someone, somewhere, had just at that very moment hacked into the red LED display. A simple animation of red stick figures having stick people sex was dancing all about the screens. Each triple digit number had its own sexual position. There were 12 in total. Here's my picture, if you can see it. I looked at this so many times. So this is, side note, this was meant as like entertainment for the times you're like fucking waiting in office or in prison or like you just hate the world.
Wait, what?
Everything sucks. This is like fun entertainment. All right. So he looks around and starts to panic. What is going on? Why does no one see this? At least one other applicant had discovered the stick people orgy. Looking around, bewildered and confused. She nudges her friend and they snort out loud in a hysterical giggle. As his eyes dart around the room looking for answers, the officer notices the water stains in the corner of the room on the floor. Clearly, there were plants here at one point in time. The office plants, probably, that no one feels obligated to take care of. He knows how that goes. The plants in his own office were bought at IKEA and are most likely fake anyway. Because how do they stay green even though no one waters them? The green one was special, because most of the plants in the headquarters were shriveled remnants of previously living beings. He ponders when the last time someone ever bothered to water them. Side note, the plants were liberated by the Plant Liberation Front, the anarchists, with the bombing earlier. So he's like, he read that article a few months ago, and now he's like conscious of like, oh, there's like this shitty stain on the ground from the plant. So just little information. Curiously, he recalls the Der Spiegel article from a while back, claiming that the plants had been taken. Could those freaks be connected to this hack right now? To distract himself from such public absurdity as the stick people pouring and blaring above his head, he coughs loudly and steps over to the corner where the water stains are on the floor. He metaphorically sniffs around on the floor where the plants used to live in, or die in, it seems, as the article had stated. He didn't actually sniff with his nose because of stress-related allergies that morning. There were some more crunches of dirt and a single dried leaf caught in a small spider web. Not much new and exciting evidence was discovered, though it should be noted that during his inconspicuous sniff of the room, he did come across a tiny folded publication left on a chair by the window. It was constructed of one sheet of A4 and folded into 8 rectangles, like a tiny magazine written by hand and photocopied. The title, "The Day I Sassed Back at the Ausländerbehörde," was an inspiring mini-zine, as it had self-identified on the introduction, page 1, on how one applicant sassed back during her meeting for a residence permit. After being repeatedly suggested to leave the country for lack of legitimate government-approved job, she stood up and proclaimed to her interviewer, "Why don't they hire her as an artist to paint the boring, ugly-ass walls and give her an artist visa while they're at it?" She slapped the walls to emphasize their bleakness and slammed shut the door to the office. She didn't get the visa, but felt damn good walking down the hall, able to sass back enough auf Deutsch. The officer is confused upon completion of the zine. Who is this person? They sound like a troublemaker. But the zine was published anonymously. There was no way he could hunt down the maker, for there was no digital footprint embedded into the analog sheet of single tree paper. Real fingerprints, perhaps, but that old school tech was another department at the agency. Handwriting analysis, perhaps, but not much else. Wait. We good? He smiled at the little thing and put it in his pocket, successfully decirculating the only zine known to exist in the temporary installation of the Ausländerbehörde Zine Library, which had only one zine. The library is now closed. The officer didn't see the tiny sign next to the zine explaining what the Auslanderbehörde zine library is and how to please respect the library collection. Respect. When he looked up at the number display after reading the zine, 212 was on the screen. Oh, how long had it been there? It wasn't flashing, so maybe it was there already. Now they'll think I'm late. And what happened to the stick people orgy? It was right there. The figures were gone without a trace, as if nothing had happened at all. He would have thought it was a daydream, but that wouldn't explain the equally confused and absurd faces of the other three individuals in the room, their mouths still wide open in disbelief. The ones in the waiting room who didn't notice it had their own papers and problems to be confused about. The officer stands up to walk to room 212 and decides before entering that explaining the hack that just happened would probably not be the best introduction to such a legal and bureaucratic meeting. Later, 30 minutes later, he is walking out of the building with a stamped piece of shiny paper in his passport. With all the insider connections to the National Security Agency, since he was the officer there, of course, he could easily have hacked it himself. He noticed in the office with the Auslanderbehörde lady just how simple their systems of distribution are. Judging by their analog system of beat-up rubber stamps and how he once met a criminal punk at a police station who had dumpstered the Bundesdruckerei, the state printer, where they print all the visas, and he found the same kind of holographic paper used on visas in the dumpster. So anything of the physical world was much easier to create than, say, replicating a digital PGP signature. But he thought he would give Germany a break and let them officially acknowledge him through the front door. At the Wedding U-Bahn platform, Polizei were swarming. He nodded at them in a kind of sickly way, acknowledging themselves as equals on some level, though he felt really uneasy by it. They were doing the worst kind of filth, pulling aside only people of color assumed to be refugees on their way to a visa meeting. If one was caught without a valid and paid for U-Bahn ticket, their ID was searched, which would then reveal their potentially not yet legal status because they were going to get a visa literally at that moment. That happens, by the way. Happens every day. The officer has seen a lot of sketchy stuff happen in the underbellies of the NSA. But having been a visa applicant himself, he found this police tactic particularly disgusting. He bought 4 extra tickets and left them in the collection pocket of the machine for anyone who might discover them and need them. Charity. He boarded the train without a word to the police officers. The train pulled out of the station and headed south on the U6 towards Platz der Luftbrücke, where he would walk to the Tempelhofer headquarters. The officer again stares out the window at the dark tunnel walls going by and by. And he recalls the quote by someone famous, an old indigenous woman perhaps, who he read while he was tasking the Earth First Journal magazine. Something it said like, "If you have come to help me, please go home. If you have come because you see your liberation wrapped up in mine, then let us work together." He thought of the word, liberation. Perhaps there was something to be learned. Thank you.
Hey, come back.
Fantastic. That was once again Comet Crowbar reading from Crypto Cunt and the Ecosexuals. So I'm going to say once again, this was a beta. Working out the bugs, working out the thing. But I hope that everyone understands that we just watched 6 brave people walk into the abyss of a room full of eyes and speak, sing, Rubik's Cube solve,
oh, we can still get a
juggle,
spectrum, right?
And I don't know what the other part was for you all.
Straight out of Compton.
What? We didn't vote yet.
Who wants to sing?
We need to vote.
Voting
comes next.
Voting. So judges, 3, 2, 1.
Can I add one comment? Because I live in Berlin and I've spent many hours in the Auslanderbehörde, and that story was amazing.
What the fuck is this?
What the fuck?
What's this? Is this a late entry?
Seven!
Is this Donald Trump's assistant?
Back for revenge.
Stop saying Donald Trump.
I call this Cory Doctorow After Dark. That's mine.
This could have saved us a lot of time.
Yeah, I know. But anyway, well, Starshine, thank you for your guest appearance.
Starshine?
I think we need you to come up here and do a little dance while the judges discuss our,
music? Huh? Have you got some music?
Well, I think these people are fully capable of making music.
Yeah, give us a clap.
Once I was afraid, I was petrified. Come on, let's
was?
Go. Steven went by my side. I should have changed that goddamn lock. I should have thrown away the key. If I'd think of just 1 second, you'd be back to bother me. But now, ow, I will survive. No matter how I will it down to live. I forgot the words again. I got all my love to give. I got all my life to live. And I'm dying. I will survive. Hey, hey. Okay, so band. That's on my resume.
Come get some stickers.
There's a lot going on here. I'm having a.
Our
I'm having what would
can
just be called a spectrum of emotions right now.
I think
right
I had blinky light overload.
So what do? Do we bring up the matrix of numbers?
I think we just add.
Do we add?
Well, Kyle's got to add.
We're fucked. We're not. We got to add. Yes, Kyle.
I think everyone is on drugs at this point.
I'm not. I'm just on hope. Not since the Popsicle Twins versus Chuck Barris. Look it up, kids.
This reminds me of that movie Party Monster.
Yeah, this is where Macaulay Culkin kills a guy, I think.
So we have a question here. First of all, the question is does somebody gate crashing count as an entry?
What? I was just told to come up here, guys.
Were you just wandering around?
It's a dangerous. Okay.
I think
the dangerous precedent.
The crowd has spoken. I think we need to vote on this.
Okay, so our final contestant.
Okay.
Our final contestant has a lot of daddy issues. Wait, final contestant.
I can't hear anything you're
saying. Final contestant, wait. What is your name? What do we call you?
Already getting
what name
prize.
Do we call you? What do we call you to summon you again?
We call her. Thank you, Dad, for the art.
Taking high that I've never been before. I'm holding the back, just one shot of the moon.
You're literally risking disqualification.
Just a chance that to keep on dreaming. You're just another day that keeps me breathing. Baby, I love the way that there's something strong. Baby, don't stop me. Hide away with me some more.
Thank you. Technology conference.
Full disclosure.
You don't understand. We're going to learn. Mom, I gotta go because I'm gonna learn all this new knowledge and it's gonna be good for my degree.
I think I'm on drugs right now. I'm not sure.
I think this might be my first.
But I mean,
drug.
It's really not. I mean, they're really nice
people. So I ordered a large on Amazon. They gave me a small. So this is my summer suit. Sorry, Mom, about the camel toe. Whoops.
Mask stranger, what is your name? What is your name for the judges, please?
She won't tell you her name.
Jesus Christ!
She will not tell you her name.
What is her name? What is your name, contestant?
By the way, this is now the funkiest hope.
Yeah.
It is.
Tell us what you're called.
That was pretty funny.
Do you have a name?
Tell us what you're called.
We shall name her.
please tell us what you're called.
I guess I've got a new handle.
Hope is dedicated to a harassment-free conference experience for everyone. The Hope
it
series
was
of events are open, including forums for sharing of ideas. It is important for participants to step beyond prejudices, societal norms, and other perspectives that lead to a disrespect for people and groups. Everyone's welcome regardless of race, class, gender identity or expression, age, ethnicity, religion, political beliefs, disability, sexual orientation, personal appearance, or educational level, text editor choice, and other aspects of who we are. We are a space for tolerance or respect. If you're taking crowd shots, please announce your intentions to the crowd to allow people to look away. Boy, that warning came
your new handle is Cockhorse.
Hi.
Are we good?
We're good. Whoa. Oh, no, that's... We're great. Oh, no.
I think everyone is on drugs.
Okay, so camel toe. Number seven. Oh, boy. You never go out the same way you came in. All right, so, Jesus Christ. All right, okay, so judges.
Remember us?
Are you prepared, judges? 3, 2, 1. Oh, man. Thank God Rob is being taken out of the special secret back entrance at the end. I
didn't know we could do that. That's amazing.
Wow. I'm still not sure what happened.
Yeah, no, that's not. No, don't ruin it. Don't. We'll just wake up tomorrow and
she's
act like it didn't happen.
She's the reason I crashed.
We're just gonna.
I was just suiting up in the ladies' room. She's like, come with me.
I'll tell you something. I'm just jealous because I've been wearing that exact same thing under this outfit all con and nobody said a thing.
I swear to God, I've forgotten about the time that guy told me a really long story about his resume. I'll tell you that. It's gone. You
so
got rid
he.
Of it. It's gone.
So I have a question. Can you solve Rubik's Cubes?
Okay. So I guess do we move forward to the come on up, Kyle.
We have numbers now.
Kyle, the one straight numbers person in all of this who's kept track of anything, all these numbers. We're just doing a straight ad.
It all comes down to the numbers.
He's just an accountant. Don't attack him. He's just adding numbers up. So let's go with. We're gonna go with. Let me just take a quick look at numbers. Okay. So. Yeah, we're all winners. Yeah, though, tell yourself that. Tell yourself. Take that home and hug it.
Except for that one guy.
Only millennials are.
26, 28.
I think okay, judges are the real winners here.
I think so, yes.
That is
wow.
I have to process what I just saw. That was
I have to process it too, to be honest. But okay, let's do this. Let's do this. So at 25 points. Let me make sure I'm not screwing anybody. Okay, at 25 points, it's Stephen Martin Cohen and a very interesting story. Up and wave. Do you have any... Okay, do you have a few short words for the audience?
I thought the three was going to kill me, but... I have a very long memory.
What have I done?
Down my throat.
God forgive me.
It all started with a sperm and an egg. No, I
just give him the damn prize already. You won, man. You
Stephen
won.
Martin Cohen, Google that name, buy my books on Amazon so that I can make my subway fare to get home. No, really, you like the techno thrillers, and my best fans are cops and doctors because I pay attention. One of the seminars said, I pay attention to the little details.
Thank you.
The little details.
Oh. Okay. So, in second place, we have a three-way tie.
How was that second place then?
We have a three-way tie for second. Look, I don't know. I don't get this either, but that's what we did. Everyone shut up. This is,
Wait, no, you wrote the numbers down. It's your fault.
That means he's in fifth place.
We have a first... Shut up. Now, but it is Cheshire Catalyst. It is Dave... reading the Hacker Manifesto, and it is, who's the third one? Comic Crowbar. So that's a three-way tie for those. And all three of you, you're welcome to come up and say something to the audience. You've done it. You've killed Cheshire Catalyst. He's now died. So, yep. Anybody else? No? Okay, fine. All right.
We know
the
system's
rigged. Fucking rigged.
Yeah.
Wait, there's a system?
Old news.
And now, you can go give Camel Toe your own special prize later. Jesus Christ!
Maybe we can teach him a new word. I don't know.
Tonight we are all the worst version of ourselves. No, I'm going to say based off pure math. And I'm sorry, math is your friend. The winner is Mandy with Juggling in Darkness. Come on up, Mandy. Mandy wins the Mr. Robot Pleasure Pack. And and please, Mandy, a little speech for these people.
I didn't actually prepare a speech, so... Thanks.
All right. Thank you. Well, this has been an abject lesson in something. I don't know what to say. Things happened that were not on the schedule.
We'd like to thank Donald Trump's nephew who's in the
stop
audience.
Stop saying Donald Trump.
It's been a pleasure knowing all of you. So again, please, once again, can we have a round of applause for six brave people?
Don't you mean seven?
Seven brave people.
And a little round of pointing boos to the hecklers. Boo!
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 Remember, next year, this is for the hecklers. When you're here next year,
we won't be.
You can be on
every 2 years.
Don't. See you next year, hecklers. Thank you to you all for staying here, for being supportive, for being part of the fun. Thanks to our judges for working out how to count. And thanks to the impromptu AV packed up by our people. None of that was planned, I promise you. Please enjoy the night. New York is safe, but not that safe. And please.
After party on the roof.
Yeah. Remember, if you go on the roof, it'll be an experience you will not soon forget, because it'll be in your record. Thanks, everybody. We love you. See you tomorrow for the last day of hope.
Somebody took my patch.
Yeah, sure.